going to speak on purify the heart. The heart need to be purified. And that's something where about most people don't think about the heart, or that their heart need to be right before God. Sometimes people think, you know, a lot about other things, but then they don't think about the heart, you know. So what is your motive? Do you love God with everything? Whereabout he told us in Luke 10:27, Jesus said, answered them, he said, you shall love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart, all of it. God don't want us to be half-hearted. He don't want us to have our allegiance somewhere else. He wants the entire heart of man. He said, love him with all your heart and with all your soul. Your inner man has to love God also. And then he said, with all your strength and with all thy mind and thy neighbor as thyself. You know, this is a great God. He wants us to love him with everything, no exceptions. You know, no divided. Our allegiance, as far as our heart, has to be to God. And I want to tell you, this pure, the word talking about purifying your heart. To purify your heart means your heart has to be clean. Your heart has to be genuine. It has to be without defects. It can't be mixed. You can't have a mix of anything in your heart when you love God. He said, with no evil. And he said, without a sin, but you must have what? A pure mind. A pure mind. Your mind has to be pure. Because he told us in Matthew 5:8, he said, blessed are the pure in heart. So that let me know our hearts got to be right with God. You know, we can't have a mixed allegiance. We can't, part of our heart is with God and the other part is not with God. It's time out for that. It's time to be sincere with your heart, with God. That means to love him, what? With everything. He's not going to accept anything half-hearted. He's not going to accept half-hearted people. People that go into church and saying, well, it's okay as long as I go to church. That time is over with. It's time to see God with what? Your whole heart. And to love him, what? With everything. That's the honest way we can love God with a pure heart, is to love him, what? With everything that's in us. He said, the pure in heart, your heart has to be pure, being free from what? Sin. You might say, I'm not sinning, but if you're not loving God with everything, guess what? There's still some sin in your heart, because there's something room for something else. He said, without being a divided interest, all your loyalty, it has to be what? All of us who possess Christ in us, we got to love him what? With all our heart. Then he tells us how we are to love him. He said in John 15:3, he said, you are clean through the word. This is how our hearts are purified, is what? Through the word of God. He said, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. The word of God is the only cleaning agent that will purify our heart. The blood cleanses us, but it takes the word of God to what? To purify our heart. And then when we hear the word, we got to what? Obey the word. That's what it is. Because James said, be what? Doers of the word and not just hearers only. Yeah, hearing is good, but if you just hearing it and ain't doing it, it ain't doing no good. Meaning you got to apply this thing. I thank you. You got to apply this word, what? To your life. It's important to listen, but one must not stop there. He got to go on and be what? A doer of the word. See, that is what purify our hearts. You know, people hear God's word what? All the time. But they hearing it, but are they doing it? But when you hear that word and you do it, you letting it do what? It's cleansing you, and you are becoming what? A doer, and your heart is what? Getting right towards God. Hallelujah. Then he didn't leave it there. He told us in 2 Corinthians 3:5, talking about purifying your heart. He said, examine yourself. He said, look at yourself. He said, whether you be what? In the faith. And then he turned around. He said, now you prove yourself. Meaning you give yourself a test. How do we give ourselves a test? By what? Taking the Bible and apply that Bible. See what God say. See if we are what? Passing the test on what God said do. He said, if you don't do this, he said, how did Jesus Christ in you accept? yourself what? You reprobate. That means you deceiving yourself. You fooling yourself when you think change. And I love that when I read it. I said, examine yourself. That means we know what examination is. We know when we all of us went to school, they gave what? An exam. You know? And we, then they turn around and they test us to see that what? Did we do okay on that test? So we have to take the word of God and we have to what? Apply it what? To our life. And not only apply it, but we got to be what? Doers of the word. It's time to do the word of God because Jesus is so soon to come. He's coming, even in spite of what people might think and what they say. He said, now, when you do this, then he's going to what? In Ephesians, he said 5:26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it, what? With the washing of water by the word. See, that word is important. The word of God is important. God kept this word here all through eternity. He have kept the word here for us what? So we could be what? Clean by his word. He said that he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. Just as water washed the body, guess what? So do the word of God washes what? The heart. That's what cleans our heart. That's what going to purify the heart of man is what? The word of God. Then he said in 5:27, he said he was going to present it unto himself what? That glorious church. What church? That church that heart has been what? Purified and made what? Made ready. See, that's the kind of church he's looking for, Brother Mark, because if the heart is right, guess what? Everything else is going to line up. He said that he might present unto himself a glorious church, not having a spot, a wrinkle, or any such thing, but that it should be holy and what? Without blemish. That's the only way the church, your heart going to be right, is what? By the word of God. And this is how God is going. Yes, God looking at our hearts. He trying our heart. He sees what's in our heart. He sees what's in the man of man's heart. Even though they think he don't see, but God see it. We're going to get to it. He said, because when he do this, he said that he might present it to himself that glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or blemish or such thing. But he said, who gave himself, which is Titus talking about, he gave himself that he might redeem us, what? From all iniquity, and that word is good, and purify unto himself. Ha! Purify unto himself up a peculiar people, zealous of good word. See, oh yeah, ha! See, that word purify means something to God. And we got to get down to nits and grits and know our heart has to be purified. It got to be purified 100%. It cannot be mixed. It can't have something over here. Because he said, love him with what? All of your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, and your neighbors as yourself. That means the heart got to be right. It got to be clean. Then he told us in James, he said, James 4:8. He said, draw nigh to God. Tell me, getting your heart right. And he'll do what? Draw nigh to you. He said, draw nigh to me. Come close to me. Have a close communion, relationship with me. And he said, I draw nigh to you. He said, cleanse your hands, ye sinners. If you're a sinner, you're a sinner. But if you're a sinner in the church, and you know what? You're still doing the worldly stuff, you're still a sinner. Amen. You're still a sinner because your heart is what? Divided. Let us get real. You're still out there. You're doing what the world doing. You're still a sinner. He said, clean your heart, you sinner, and do what? Purify your mind, you double-minded. Meaning a double-minded man, the next verse says, is unstable in all his way. He don't know whether he want to live for God today. He don't know whether he want to obey the Bible today. He don't know what he want to do, what God tell him to do. That means he's what? He's unstable. He been what? Tossed what? To and fro. And his heart hadn't been what? Purified for God. He said, a person of divided allegiance don't know no whether he want to obey the Bible or not. He's a what? He's unstable. He's unstable. Jeremiah said in 17:9, he's talking about that heart. He said the heart is what? It deceitful above what? All things. The heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? But then he let us know in Jeremiah 17:10, he said, I, the Lord, he said, searches the heart. God is searching the heart. He said, I know. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways, according to what? To the fruit of his doing. See, you can fool me, and I can fool you, But God is doing what? He's searching our hearts. He's seeing whether our hearts are what? Purified before him. Now, we can't fool. We can fool other people, but we sure can't fool God. So we need to not get it together. Get it together. Church world, we need to what? Get it together. Because God is what? Looking at our heart. He said the fruit of his dawn. Then he told us over in Revelation, he said, I know. He's searching your heart. He said, I know your works. He said, that they are neither cold nor hot. He said, I would they were cold or hot. Meaning, I will know what you're doing. I know what kind of works you're doing. He said, I want your full allegiance to me. I want the full thing. I want your pure heart for me. He said, your full allegiance to me or nothing. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot be what? Divided. You cannot be half-hearted. Because God said, he knows our works. And he knows our hearts. He said, so then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold or hot, he said he'll do what? Spew you out. He'll spit you out of his mouth. And we always say that. He is saying, you make me sick. Why? Because Timothy said, 2 Timothy 3:5, he said, you have a form of godliness, but you denying the power thereof. From such turn away. You got a form. You ain't got the real thing. Your heart is what? Divided. So you got a form of God not and denying the power there. Oh, thank the Lord. Then he said, then Titus, he said, because he did what? No, because he gave himself that he might redeem us and purify unto himself a peculiar people. Thank the Lord for that. And over and he said, we need to do a Psalms 139:23. We need to ask God to search us. Oh God. And know my heart, which he already know our heart. Then tell him to try us and know my thoughts. See if there be any wicked ways, meaning if my heart is what? Not pure in you. And I'm gonna put this in there. Take it out, God. And lead me into the way everlasting to have a pure heart. Amen. In Ephesians 4:24, he said, put off concerning the former conversation, that old lifestyle, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on a new man, which is after God, created in righteousness and true holiness. Get a pure heart. Let God's word come and purify your hearts so that when he come in 2 Timothy, we'll find ourselves where he said the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. He said the dead in Christ gonna rise first. Then we who are alive, meaning our hearts has to be pure. We're going to be changed. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So let us comfort one another with those words, knowing that Jesus is soon to come. Amen. Amen. And then one more thing. He told him in Psalms 51:2, 51:7, and 51:10. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Purge me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew the right spirit within me. You can't love God complete without a pure heart, and you must have the right spirit within you, which is the Holy Ghost. And I thank God for his word.
Amen. We thank God for his word, and we thank God for being with us. Thank God for the opportunity, and we want to say a quick word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy towards us, God, and I pray now that you would touch me, God. that you would help me to bring your word, God, with clarity and conviction, God. Let it go forth, God, as you have ordained it, God. And we thank you now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 And we thank God today for his word. And today I just want to deal with God's wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. God's wisdom, his knowledge, and his understanding. Now, all throughout the Bible, I mean, there are so many scriptures. It's the Bible talks about wisdom, knowledge, and understanding so much. So there's no way we could kind of compact it down into one lesson. But I just want to share with you today what God has been showing me concerning wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. So the first question is, why these three are often named together? Even throughout the Bible, we often see them named together. And what God showed me was that in order to have wisdom, you must have both knowledge and understanding. At the very core of it, you must have understanding. And understanding is dealing with your ability to understand or comprehend or perceive something. And this is where the devil trips us up a lot of times, because that's what the enemy tries to attack the most, is our understanding, whether it be through misunderstandings or even just having a bad understanding. But this is not what God has designed for us. He tells us in Proverbs 4:7, he tells us, in all thy getting, get what? An understanding. Because without comprehension, without that ability, you won't be able to learn. And if you think about your everyday dealings with just with people in the natural sense, most of the time when misunderstandings arise, it's because one or both parties do not comprehend the sentiments of the other. And it is lack of understanding. It often comes from our own preconceived ideas. In other words, we approach a situation or something with something already in our minds. Our mind is already set in a certain direction. And this is what leads us to having lack of understanding when we're dealing with situations in our lives. Just think about it. When we were growing up, when we were small and just starting out in school, we didn't argue with the teacher when the teacher said 1 + 1 = 2, did we? But we learned how they came to that conclusion, and now upon that, we've built our basic understanding of how math works. So in order to get understanding at any level in life, whether it's spiritual or natural, we have to be willing to learn, willing to comprehend, willing to perceive what is being said or what God is trying to show us. And once we have established that understanding, once we have established that ability to comprehend, then comes the knowledge. And knowledge is dealing with facts, information, and skills acquired through experience or education. You have to be able to look at a situation and apply the facts through your understanding, and then you'll be able to use that information to know what skills apply in that situation. On the spiritual side, when we're talking about facts, the facts that govern us are God's word, because Jesus said we are not of this world. Therefore, our knowledge base, when we're dealing with knowledge, is our knowledge base is the Bible. We go by what the Bible tells us and knowing how to deal with certain situations. Amen? Amen. And once we have established both that understanding and knowledge, then we can get on the path towards wisdom, because wisdom is combining that understanding and that knowledge and knowing then how to apply what you know in whatever situation you find yourself in. Because wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. So it's important for us in what I'm talking about today in understanding God's word and coupling that with the knowledge of his will in every situation will help us to operate in his wisdom. It's also important for us to know that God's wisdom is not the only wisdom available to us. And it's important for us to know, to make sure that when we're operating, that we are operating in God's wisdom. Because James 3:13-17 says, who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envy and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. This is the wisdom God wants to give us. He says, because also in 1 Corinthians 3:19, the wisdom of the world is foolishness with God. So the wisdom of the world is not the wisdom that will help us get from earth to glory. We must seek God for his wisdom. In Proverbs 4:7, the first part of that verse says wisdom is the principal thing. He's telling us that's what's most important. Therefore, we must get wisdom. Because having knowledge and understanding is no good if you don't know how to apply it with wisdom. So how do we get wisdom? James 1:5 answers this question plainly. He says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Why does God give wisdom liberally? I believe he does this because it's his will that we be saved. It's his will that we make it from earth to glory. And he tells us even in Jeremiah 29:11 that he knows the thoughts that he thinks towards us. Thoughts of peace and not of evil to give us an expected end. And the only way we can make it through life without fumbling and making mistakes over and over again is walking in the wisdom of God. So if we're going to make it in today's world, we have to seek God for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And we have to know that God is the only one that can give us the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding that we need. It's God that gave them wisdom in the Old Testament when he was given instructions on how to build the temple. If you read over in Exodus, there's several times where God said how he had put the wisdom and knowledge and understanding in certain people to accomplish the instructions that he was given on how to do the tabernacle and the things pertaining to it. And one of those examples, just to pull out one person, Exodus 31:2-5, he says, see, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship, to devise cunning works, to work in gold and in silver and in brass, and in cutting of stones to set them, and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. God placed it on the inside of him so that he would have the ability to carry out the instructions that he was given to Moses. And so this tells me that when God gives us something, when God gives instructions, we can't just run with it. We have to seek him for the knowledge, the wisdom, and the understanding to carry out what he is giving to us. He says, in Psalms 32:8-9, he says, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. He tells us, be not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding. This is God letting us know that we need understanding, we need knowledge, and we need wisdom most of all. And so even though we may get anxious, it's imperative that we seek God. It's imperative that, because if we don't, it could be detrimental. We can make the wrong step, the wrong move, even though God has given us what it is that he wants us to do. This does not mean, when I say we're asking God for understanding, especially, it doesn't mean that we'll always understand the why behind every situation or even the how. Because Isaiah 55:8-9, he says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. But we can ask God for understanding of what we are to do and how we are to react in the situation, especially in times of uncertainty. Just like take for example, this year, none of us knew what this year would hold. None of us knew what would befall us this year. But that doesn't mean God was caught off guard or he was caught by surprise. So what is our job in this situation? Our job is to trust him. Because our finite minds can never fully understand the vastness of God's wisdom. That's why we must trust and seek him, because he can see beyond our right now. He can see beyond our situations, and he can see his purpose fulfilled in our lives. And so it's important for us to trust him, because God is all knowing. He understands much more than what we can see right in front of us. Psalms 147:5 tells us, great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite. Isaiah 40:28, hast thou not known, hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. Ecclesiastes 11:5, as thou knowest not what is the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child, even so thou knowest not the works of God who maketh all. Romans 11:33, oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. And this is why I believe God gave us Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto your own understanding. In all of our ways, we must acknowledge him so that he can direct our path. He is all-knowing. He is wise, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. And in Matthew 11:28-30, he tells us, he says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Why is God's burden light? Because we don't have to worry about the details of our life. All we have to do is move in obedience. We have to seek God for his wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And when we're seeking God, it's not going to be some loud voice telling us. We then have to listen for his prompts, because God is he's not going to bombard his way. When that opportunity presents itself for us to obey God and to move in a certain direction, he's going to give us what to do. But you have to have your spirit quiet enough to hear what God is leading you to do. And I wanted to pull in also in the New Testament, Paul, when he wrote to the church in Colossae, he tells them, he said, I'm praying for you. And he said, I'm praying because I desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. This, I believe, applies even to us today, because we need spiritual understanding. And that spiritual, one part of that spiritual understanding we find in Ephesians 6:12, where he tells us, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. It's important for us to have a spiritual understanding and knowing what we're dealing with in these days and times. And then he says, knowledge of his will, the knowledge of God's will. And we can find in Romans 12:1-2, where he tells us, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. When we combine our understanding of the spiritual with our knowledge of God's will for us, then we can combat the enemy with wisdom, knowing how to apply what God has given us, and ultimately will win spiritual warfare.
Book of Genesis, the 17th chapter, in the first verse. Amen. We thank God for his word. Amen. And it says, "And when Abram was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect." And just for a few moments, I pray that you would pray with me. I'm going to speak on perfect your faith. Amen. And Abraham is one of the Bible's most essential figures of faith. His faith in God was imputed or accounted to him for righteousness. God promised that he would be the father of many nations. And because of Abraham's faith and obedience to this God, who out of nowhere began to reach out to him, our Savior Jesus came through his lineage. Genesis 22 and 18 says, "And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice." And it is in Jesus whom the Apostle Paul says in Romans 3 that now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Yes, we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But thank God that we have been justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And thank God that he is not the God of the Jews only, but he is also the God of the Gentiles. So then Paul also continued in Romans 4 and 16, where he said, "Therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all." And Paul also wrote in Ephesians 2 and 8, he said, "By grace ye are saved, that through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." And look at what all was made possible because the Lord chose to reveal himself to Abraham, and Abraham chose to put his faith in God. However, the journey was not smooth sailing. It wasn't peaches and creams for Abraham. In fact, grace even appeared unto Abraham. When we look in Genesis 16, in the 16th chapter of Genesis, we find Sarah, Abraham's wife, has a conversation with him about going in unto her maiden because she cannot see how God can cause her to have children. So the only feasible answer she could see in the moment was to let her maiden marry Abraham and conceive children for her. And Abraham hearkens unto her. But this was not God's will for how he wanted to bring to pass his promise to Abraham. Therefore, when the maiden Hagar conceived, she turned on her mistress Sarah. And what was meant to help bring about God's promise ended up bringing about trouble. And for many of us, if we be honest, we know we heard God. We know God had made us a promise. We know it was God that put that dream, that goal in our heart. But somewhere along the line, our faith got weary. Our faith got cloudy. And it got cloudy, and we just couldn't see how God would bring it to pass. And we, too, have done some things and made some choices outside of the will of God, and it's backfired on us. And now we can see how foolish and how wrong we were. So we have found ourselves in a predicament like Miss Sarah, in which what we did in our flesh, thinking that it would help, ended up turning on us.
So we, especially as saints, must pause and examine, why it is that we have found ourselves here. Perhaps it was fear. Perhaps it was desperation or anger or jealousy or envy or the pressure from doubting friends and family. But whatever it was, we have to understand that it was not God's will. And now that we can see the error of our ways, sometimes it troubles us. Sometimes to the point where it seems like the promise is no longer for us. Or it seems like the dream or the goal is sure enough impossible now. But we can take joy and find hope in the fact that there is another chapter. Yes, and that's where we pick up our text. What makes this next chapter in the book of Genesis great is the fact not just that Abraham is still around, but also that the Lord pays Abraham another visit. And he comes with a special message for Abraham. But look at what his message is. It's not you've messed up so bad that even I can't help you. It's not you're too far gone. It's not it's over for you. But what does God tell Abraham after he's messed up? What does God tell him after he's gotten out of his will and helped cause the trouble in his own house? What does God tell him after Abraham has hearkened to his wife Sarah? God says, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And if you're not shouting, if you're not dancing, if you're not giving God praise by now, let me encourage you by explaining what's going on in the text and in Abraham's life. If I could sum it up, I would say grace. Look at the grace of God. Yes, Abraham messed up, but your mess didn't stop me from being God. Not only am I God, but I am the Almighty God. I'm greater than your mess up. I'm greater than your foolishness. I'm greater than your sin. I'm still good for my word. Yes, and even though you've been unfaithful, I am still faithful. I still love you, and I'm still with you, and I still want to use you. I still have a great plan for you, and I haven't lost control. I'm not at a loss scratching my head trying to figure out what I'm going to do because I am the Almighty God, and I declare the end at the beginning. And that's why I'm giving you another chance. And so some of us, we've been in that place or may even be there now where we've needed the Lord to speak to us again. We've needed him to visit us again. And God, in his great mercy and his good grace, had visited us again and let us know that, yes, I know you got out of my will. I know you didn't wait on me. I know you gave in to the fear and the doubt that I wouldn't do what I said. I know your lack of patience has gotten you into a situation that you can't shake. And even since you've been in it, you've made it even worse for yourself. But I still am the Almighty God. And I'm greater than your folly. I'm greater than the trap that the enemy set for you and you fell in. I'm greater than the deepest hole that you found yourself in. And just because you stopped believing in me doesn't mean I stopped being God. And he showed us that he's still the God, the Hebrews 7:25 God, who is able to save to the uttermost. He showed us that he's still the Isaiah 59:1 God, whose hand is not shortened that it cannot save. His ear is not heavy that it cannot hear. He showed us that he's still the Jeremiah 32:27 God, who is the Lord, the God of all flesh. And there is nothing too hard for him. And so even if you are currently finding yourself in this situation, in a situation where you feel like you've messed up so bad that God won't fulfill his promise to you, I'm here to let you know that he is here to save you. He's here to rescue you. He's here to deliver you and give you another chance. If he has to reach way down, somebody said he can pick you up. He can pick you up out of the miry clay, cleanse you, and set your feet on a solid rock. Oh, yes. Yeah. So what should be our response to God showing up and giving us grace? It's the same as what he told Abraham. In Genesis 17:1, he said, not only did he say, I am the Almighty God, but he said, walk before me and be thou perfect. Walk before him, serve him, and follow him. But not only that, be thou perfect. And might I suggest that the perfection that God is talking about here is a heart that is perfectly trusting or having faith in God. That's why 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him." This 2 Chronicles 16:9 was part of the word from Hanani, the seer, to King Asa. When trouble arose, Asa chose to rely on the Syrian king and not rely on the Lord his God like he had done in the past. And God had already shown Asa his power by delivering the Ethiopians and the Lubans into his hand because he relied on the Lord at those times. But this time, in those times, should have perfected or strengthened his faith so that when Baasha came against him, he could see God show himself strong in his behalf. Therefore, Proverbs 3:5 lets us know we've got to trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not to our own understanding, no matter what comes up. It may look different, but it's still, God is still in control and he can still handle that situation. Oh, yes, so we have to continue to trust in the Lord with all our heart, lean unto him, and all our ways acknowledge him, and he will direct our paths. And we cannot afford to be wise in our own eyes, but we have to fear the Lord and depart from evil. So we have to continue to trust in the Lord and perfect our faith. Because when you are walking in complete, unwavering faith, then you can walk completely submitted to God and see the wonders of his glory and his miraculous power. Because it's easier for me to do what you tell me to do when I trust you. Amen. So how do we perfect our faith? Well, perfecting our faith will not result if we are passively engaged. It won't just happen. If that were the case, we wouldn't have found ourselves in the messes we created. Yes, but Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter, it lets us know that we cannot cast away our confidence because it has great recompense of reward. We have need of patience that after we've done the will of God, we can receive the promise. That's why we've got to live by faith, and we cannot draw back because we have to be of them who believe unto the saving of the soul. So to not cast away means to hold on. And in that same chapter, it tells us in the 23rd verse, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised." We have to actively engage in the process because the devil is going to do whatever possible to make us let go of our faith. That's why we find in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, that the Bible tells us to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We've got to put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand against the devil and his tricks, because we're not wrestling against flesh and blood. It's not our brother and our sister that's really the ones that we're our enemy, but it's the enemy. It's the devil that is for and against us through people sometimes to make us turn away from God, to make us give up and let go of our faith. But we are blessed because Abraham didn't have the Bible. But we have God's written word with the priceless testimonies of his faithfulness and the Holy Ghost to empower us. So may I submit to you 3 things that we should do to perfect our faith. 1, we should feed our faith and not our fear. Romans 10:17 says that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. No wonder God told Joshua, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate in it therein day and night." Yes, we have to keep God's word on our mind, because if we let that occupy our mind, it's going to be harder for the devil's seeds of doubt and unbelief to get into our spirit and to turn us. Yes, so we have to keep our mind on God's word, because God told us in Isaiah 26:3 that he will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him. Yes, and his word also provides our faith. It gives us life. It sustains us. That's why Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." And the word of God also will give us protection. It will give us protection. The Bible said in Isaiah 59 and 19 that the spirit, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard. Yes, he will lift up his word in our spirit. If we've got that word deep down rooted in us, we've been eating it, we've been feeding our faith, then the Holy Ghost has something to work with. When the devil comes to say, to discourage us and make us doubt God, the Holy Ghost has something to bring up in our spirit so that we can stand and fight against the enemy. Not only that, but Ephesians 6 and 17 lets us know that the word of God is the sword of the spirit. And we need something to fight the devil back with. And also, God's word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So when the devil comes, if you are feeding your faith, if you are eating God's word, then you have something to cut them devils off you. Cut them lies of the enemy off you. Cut that depression off. Cut that oppression, the weight of the enemy trying to weigh you down and saying you'll never see what God said. He won't do what he said. Cut that devil off you and walk in God's freedom in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so the second thing I want to encourage us to do to perfect our faith is to just believe God's word. Because his word gives us hope. His word will help us. When we are hoping in his word, it's going to help us to stand strong. Romans 15 and 4 says, whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. No wonder the psalmist said in Psalm 119, my soul fainteth for thy salvation, but I hope in thy word. The word is a lamp unto my feet. It's a light unto my path. So I hate vain thoughts. I hate those thoughts that are trying to discourage me. I know I don't want that stuff on my mind, but I want God's word on my mind because I love God's word. And it's my hiding place and my shield. That's why I hope in God's word. Lastly, I want to encourage us to do the word of God. John 8 and 31, Jesus said, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Yes, and in Luke 11 and 28, he said, but yea, rather blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. So we've got to do the word of God. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. Amen. So I've come to encourage us that when we perfect our faith and we stand strong in our faith in God, he will show himself strong in our behalf, and he will bring to pass that which is impossible by men's standards. He'll bring forth what only he can do. When he does it, you'll only be able to say, God, only God could do it. It was just a Jesus situation, and he worked it out. God did it. So if you've fainted, if you've gotten weary, if you've been unfaithful, don't stay there. But get up, and know that God will keep his promises and perfect your faith so that you can stand.